You're listening to the audio production of God Never Gives Up on You, what Jacob's story teaches us about grace, mercy, and God's relentless love, by Max Lucado, published by Thomas Nelson and read by the author. Please note that you may download an accompanying PDF that provides enhanced materials for this audiobook. To download the PDF, please visit harperchristianaudio.com.
With joy, Dean Lynn and I dedicate this book to Travis and Alicia Eads and their children Jackson, Landon, Weston, and Annie. They walk with God, lead with faith, and worship with glad hearts. We are honored to serve alongside them. Acknowledgements. A volume of thanks would not be enough to express my gratitude for the team behind this book. They dedicate themselves to the creation of quality messages and books. To them, I happily offer a standing ovation. Liz Haney and Karen Hill, editors who coax this stubborn mule of an author to clean up phrases and tighten up paragraphs. Carol Bartley, the best copy editor on the planet. David Drury, a theological safeguard against wayward thoughts. Steve, Cheryl, and Caroline Green, dearest of friends and the most faithful of workers. The HarperCollins Christian Publishing team. Mark Schoenwald, Don Jacobson, Andrew Stoddard, Mark Glessney, Erica Smith, Bria Woods, Janine McIver, and Laura Minshew. Greg, Susan, and Andrew Ligon, captains who keep this boat afloat and on target. The Dunham Group, so thankful for your timely and creative ideas. Dave Treat, prayer leader and Christ lover. Jenna Munsinger and Pamela McClure, publicists who can leap buildings with a single bound. Janie Padilla and Margaret Machinas, steady and dependable, thank you. Andrea Lucado Ramsey, more than a daughter, a co-worker. Great work, Dre. Brett, Jenna, Rosie, Max, Rob, Andrea, Jeff, and Sarah, you occupy a place in this papa's heart that is all yours. Love you forever. Dean Lynn, my bride, though it's been well over 4 decades since our wedding, never will I forget the sight of you walking down the aisle. I saw your smile, and that's the last I've seen of my heart. You, the reader, if you choose to entrust me with your time, I'll do my best to honor your trust. God bless you. And to you, my Holy Father, I offer the greatest thanks. I, like Jacob, am inconsistent and forgetful. Yet I, like Jacob, am secured by the strong hand of heaven's grace, and I am forever grateful. Chapter 1, The Tilted Halo Society. If you are a super saint, this book is not for you. If your halo never tilts, your faith never wavers, your Bible never closes, and your feet never stray from the straight and narrow, let me save you some time. You won't relate to this story. Are you squeaky clean? Is this your only question about faith? Why would people question their faith? Is your heart so fully set on heaven that you use pearlygate.com as your email address? Do you begin your day with an Our Father and end your day with an Amen and never interrupt the prayer? If so, congratulations. My hat is off to you. Here is a standing ovation. And here is an honest disclaimer. These chapters were not written with the likes of you in mind. This book is for members of the Tilted Halo Society, for the strugglers among us and the fumbler within us. For those of us who are part saint, part scoundrel, we mean well, but do well? Well, we don't always. We have breakthroughs for sure, but breakdowns as well, often in the same hour. We need no reminder of our failures. We have not forgotten them. But we could use a refresher course on God's stubborn refusal to give up on us. And no one is more suited to the task than Jacob, the flawed patriarch. He is, by definition, a patriarch, yet in the team photo of Bible heroes, he looks out of place. There stand Abraham and Isaac with their rush of hair, strong shoulders, and chiseled features. Mount Rushmore-ish they are. Then there's Jacob, the little guy wearing the sunglasses and poker visor. He doesn't seem to fit. Jacob's nickname contains the same consonants as the Hebrew word for heel, appropriate as he exited the womb with his hand on his twin brother's heel, as if to say, "Oh, no, you don't, you fuzzy brother. I want the top spot." A triumph of irony, this was, Jacob beginning life the way he would live it, grasping for a better position. Jacob's nickname was deceiver, and deceive he did. He took advantage of his famished sibling, pulled the wool over the eyes of his dying father, and met his father-in-law's guile with guile. Prodigy? No. Prodigal? That fits. Jacob never fed the pigs, but he did wrestle in the mud with, if not God, someone like God. All night the two grunted, gripped, and groped until, as the day broke, Jacob pinned him down and begged for a blessing. The blessing came, but at a cost. Jacob was given a new name, Israel, but Israel's hip was out of joint. He walked with a limp. Sound familiar? You've wrestled with God about your past, your future, your pain, and problems. You, like Jacob, have walked away with a gimp in your spiritual gait. Some people mount up with wings like eagles. A few run and never grow weary. Others walk and never faint. You, me, Jacob, we limp. Jacob's story is for limpers. I spoke with a limper last evening. We sat together at a dinner party. A dozen folks shared a meal, a bottle of wine, and a gorgeous South Texas sunset. The husbands sat outside on a backyard deck. I was the newcomer. "What kind of work are you in, Max?" I winced at the question. Nothing dampens lively conversation more quickly than the discovery of a clergyman in the circle. Confession, when I'm on a flight and am asked about my profession, my answer depends on my energy level. If I'm in a mood to chat, I say writer. If not, I say preacher. "Well, I'm a pastor." Silence. The super saints at the table, there is usually one or two, shared news about their Bible study in which they have learned so much. The limpers, there are always several, apologized for their language and made a joke about passing the offering plate after dessert. The chit-chat resumed, but the fellow to my right, in a voice intended for my ears only, began to talk about his faith, or lack thereof. If he wasn't 80 years old in age, he certainly was in appearance. His eyelids drooped to half-mast. His shoulders slumped. He puffed on a cigar and sipped on a glass of Pinot Noir. His uncle, he told me, was a pastor. The uncle had baptized him in an Alabama river. But that was 7 decades ago. He's buried a child since then, buried some dreams as well. He's built and lost a business or two since then. He's wrestled with God since then. "I guess I'm God's lost cause," he said. He would find a kindred spirit in Jacob. Jacob's story is hard to read because he misbehaves so often. Then again, the Jacob story is a relief to read because we misbehave so often. And we wonder if God could love and use Jacob, might he be willing to do the same with us? Jacob lived 147 years, yet the heart of his narrative covers only 20 years of his life, ages 77 to 97, and 11 chapters in the book of Genesis, Genesis 25 through 35. We know very little about Jacob's life outside of those 20 years, but what we know of those two decades is worth pondering. The setting is southern Israel, some 2,000 years before Jesus was born. The main characters are Bedouins, tent dwellers, and sheep watchers. The land about them is vast and rugged. Their story is a multi-layered mosaic that begins with Jacob's grandfather. Abraham was wealthy in herds and flocks, silver and gold. He was also affluent in faith, so rich, in fact, that he set out from his homeland in search of a new land that would serve as the heartland of a new nation. His faith allowed for a new nation, but not a new baby. When God told Abraham and his wife Sarah that it was time to buy a stroller and decorate a nursery, they cracked up. Abraham was pushing 100 years of age. She was nigh on 90. The thought of bouncing a baby on bony knees left them in stitches. She made a joke about parents and child being equally toothless. Abraham agreed, "We'll all be wearing diapers." He fell on his face in a fit of laughter, and she giggled herself into a knot. But the baby came. They named him Chuckles. Well, not exactly, but they might as well have, because Isaac means laugh. Proof that when it comes to miracles, God has the last laugh. In his later years, Abraham decided to find Chuckles a wife. Abraham sent a servant back to the land of his birth to get a wife for my son, Genesis 24 and verse 4. The servant prayed for God to give him success. He had barely said an amen when he looked up and saw Rebekah, Isaac's wife-to-be. The servant sought the blessing of Rebekah's father and the permission of her brother. The brother was named Laban. Remember that name. In short order, he will trick Jacob, who had just tricked his father Isaac and his brother Esau. Lots of tricking in this story. Laban gave Rebekah to the servant. The servant gave Rebekah to Isaac. Isaac gave his heart to Rebekah. And Rebekah gave twin sons, Jacob and Esau, to Isaac. There was tension between the brothers from the get-go. Rebekah's womb felt like a cage fight. The children struggled together within her, Genesis 25:22. The description in Hebrew reads, "The children smashed themselves inside her." Once, as they kicked at each other, she begged God for an explanation. He gave this, "Two nations are in your body, and two groups of people will be taken from you. One group will be stronger than the other, and the older will serve the younger." Genesis 25:23. In the ancient clan plan, the elder son would inherit superior rank over the younger. Yet in God's plan, Jacob would trump Esau. The older will serve the younger. Had God not said it, Rebekah never would have imagined it. When the time came for her to give birth, there were twin boys in her womb. The first to come out was red, and his whole body was like a hairy garment, so they named him Esau. After this, his brother came out with his hand grasping Esau's heel, so he was named Jacob. Genesis 25:24-26. Esau grew to look like the guy in charge, manly, ruddy, and hairy. So hairy that they named him Harry, or in the mother tongue, Esau, which rhymes with seesaw, an apt name for a man whose life was destined to be full of ups and downs. Esau was a hunter. He had a closet of camo gear and drove a 4x4 truck complete with a rifle rack, mud tires, and a bumper sticker that read, "I'd rather be fishing." He was never so happy as when he was tracking a deer or stirring a covey of quail. Bucks, ducks, trucks. That was Esau's world. Chuckles loved him. And Rebecca loved Jacob. He was more metro than macho, more bookish than brawn, more indoor than outdoor, more Saturday in the library than weekend in the wild. Jacob was, well, let me just say it.
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.